We're standing in one of the most significant sites in Israel in terms of the enormity of the findings in this area. We're standing in the place where, probably around 1946, a Bedouin shepherd comes in this area with his flocks, and he's lost one of his animals. And so he decides to go looking in the caves, and he picks up a stone, maybe something like this, and he throws it into the cave. And as it hits the floor of the cave, he understands that it is not hitting the floor, but rather it's hitting something else, which in fact was a pottery vessel. Now in 1946, he doesn't have a mobile phone, he doesn't have a flashlight, and it's evening, it's getting dark. So he decides to come back the following morning, and he brings some of his friends with him to help him in this investigation. And he climbs up the mountains into one of the many caves in this area. And he goes into the cave and he finds 8 pottery vessels. Inside some of them, there was dried fruit. Inside others, there was absolutely nothing. But the fascinating discovery that he finds is scrolls. Now in 1946, scrolls have never been found in this land before. And the Bedouin is not an archaeologist, so he has no idea of the ramifications or the value of what he has found. So these scrolls begin to find their way into the black market, to antiquities dealers and so on. And as more are discovered in the area, some of them even end up in the United States of America, where they're advertised in the Washington Post. Now Israel gets wind of this, and eventually they end up in the hands of Professor Sukenik. And one day he is sitting in his study with trembling hands as he painstakingly tries to peel this scroll open without allowing it to disintegrate in front of him. And as he opens the scroll, and as he sees the Hebrew text of one of the scrolls of Isaiah opening in front of his eyes, his son runs into the room, animated, with a transistor radio in his hand, saying, "Abba, Abba, listen to this." At the exact moment that he understands that he has the Hebrew Bible in his hands, his son is coming into the room and on the broadcast is saying the votes for the plan to partition Palestine that was giving Israel a legal right to exist as a nation and to be reborn in a day, as the prophet Isaiah foretold more than 2,700 years ago. What an extraordinary moment. Now, if you would analyze the statistical chances of all of these things happening at the same time, I think it would be almost impossible. So I think we can understand from this that this was the hand of God, that this was His timing, that the state of Israel would be founded on nothing less than the Word of God. And it was as if He was giving Israel this present, His Word. Now, the timing was extraordinary for another reason, because this area where we're standing for 19 years was under the occupation of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. Now, imagine if the scrolls had been found during that time period, what would have happened to them? Would they have been treated with honor and respect? Would they have been dispersed among the antiquities dealers, never to be discovered again? Would Israel have ever got to find them? I think not. Now, in one of the caves that is located within the modern day site of Qumran, where this special community that preserved the scrolls lived, there was not one, not two, not three, but 4 copies of the scroll of Isaiah found. And this lays to rest an argument which is often made by the Jewish people, which is that the chapter 53 of the book of Isaiah must have been inserted afterwards by the Christians because it gives such a blatant description of Messiah. Just listen to some of the words of Isaiah 53. "Who has believed our report? To whom is the arm of Adonai revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground." Now in the summer, this is surely dry ground here. "He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nor beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our pains, yet we esteemed him stricken, struck by God and afflicted. But he was pierced because of our transgressions, crushed because of our iniquities. The chastisement of our shalom was upon him, and by his stripes we were healed. Who else could that describe except our Messiah Yeshua? So the Jewish people said, impossible. It can't be that it's him. The Christians must have put this into our Bible afterwards. Now, this discovery of four scrolls of the book of Isaiah, some of which date to 135 BC, totally blow this argument out of the water. How can it have been put in the Hebrew scriptures 135 years before Yeshua the Messiah ever walked the earth if the Christians put it into the Bible? Now, if the scrolls are written 135 years BC, some of them, up until the time of the Romans, this is also an extraordinary proof of the continuity and the accuracy of the preservation of the biblical account. Until we found these scrolls, the earliest texts that we have actually date to the 9th to the 11th century AD, when they were preserved in Tiberias by a group of people living there, and these became known as the Masoretic text. And until today, that is the source that most of our translations, including the Jewish Publication Society source, is translated from. So here we have a source that predates that by almost 1,000 years. So this is really an incredible proof of the continuity of Scripture. But who were the people who were living here? And why were they preserving these texts in the desert thousands of years ago? Well, they were called the Essenes by Josephus, and they called themselves the Yachad, which simply means the community. They had come out here to live in the desert. They'd come away from Jerusalem. They wanted to live here in purity and simplicity and obedience to the Word of God. They were obsessed with ritual purity. They had 35 ritual baths out here that they used for ritual purification, especially before every single meal they ate, which means that each meal they ate was holy to them. Now, this is very striking if we think about the temple in Jerusalem, where the priesthood would eat from the sacrifices and where they would be continually preserving the scripture, copying them so that the generations to come would be able to read them. So that is how so many copies of the scripture ended up in these caves. But they didn't only preserve scripture, they also had their own texts. And some of their texts were called sectarian texts. They pertained to the life of the community. And it is clear from reading them that they believed that they were living in the days of the footsteps of Messiah. They had what I would call a very high degree of messianic expectation. Now, if they're living from 135 BC up until 70 AD in this area, guess what? They were absolutely right. They were living in the days where Messiah was going to come and plant his feet on this earth. There are also very striking similarities between their way of life and the life of John the Baptist. Their lifestyle, their purity, their separation, their message. If we think about the message of John the Baptist, which was primarily, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make a highway in the desert, and that the people were to repent and to be baptized. If we think about baptism, it is simply a continuation of the practice of mikveh, or ritual bath, that was such an important part of Jewish life in this area. So the message of John the Baptist didn't come in a vacuum, but it was very much connected to Jewish thought and to Jewish life in the Second Temple period, in this area right on the shores of the Dead Sea, the lowest place on earth, a sea which nothing can live in, a sea which anything can float on top of.